Hello, welcome back to May 2017 USM Update. We have with us a famous alumni in the field of journalism. We're going to share that. So famous, in fact, once had a conflict in public with Jerry Seinfeld. We'll tell you that story in just a minute. We have with us to the right, Neil Genzlinger, and he is a USM graduate who is now the TV critic for the New York Times. We'll come back to that in just a minute. And with him, another award-winning journalist, our present editor-in-chief of the famous Free Press, Krysteana Scribner. Krysteana has won now, just recently, from the National Media Convention, I think, three Apple Awards. So welcome to you both. Thank you for what you have done to make USM an incredibly impressive university, particularly in the field of journalism. We know a lot of our students go on in communications media studies today and hope to fulfill some of the things that you've been able to do, Neil. Neil, you worked for the, I think, the Morning Sentinel at one time, worked for the Washington Post, and now you're with the New York Times, and you you have really kind of brought a new level of critique to TV, and one that my wife reads regularly in the New York Times, so we're delighted to have you with us. Tell us a little bit about how the Free Press, you were editor-in-chief and everything else with the newspaper when you were here as a student. Tell us a little bit about your work here and how you got interested in journalism and how your career developed.
Well, I was here from 73 to 77, the old-fashioned four-year plan. And I was editor or co-editor of the paper for both junior and senior year. I had always been interested in journalism. I think I inherited a lot of that. My grandfather was a fairly well-known columnist for the Philadelphia Bulletin and the Philadelphia Public Ledger before that. So I think I inherited some of his newspaper genes, even though he died when I was quite young. So it always came sort of easily to me, and I always found myself working on the newspaper in junior high and high school, and found my way over to the Bedford Street office at some point, probably in sophomore year here. And then by the next year, I was co-editor with a guy named David Solomon, and then the year after that, I think I was editor, the sole editor.
Do you have any memories of a particular controversial issue on campus that the Free Press was right in the middle of at that time, or a particular article you're proud of, or something that kind of stands out for your experience working on the Free Press?
Well, this was still fairly not too far after the merger of the two campuses, Portland and Gorham. So there was still a fair amount of bad blood in between those two faculties, so that was an endless source of news stories. And of course, there were the ever-present and chronic budget problems, cutting this, cutting that, and so I suspect if you
we've never had any budget problems since.
None of that exists anymore. Good to hear it. So I think if you just clip the headlines out of my Free Presses, you could pretty much you put them in your Free Presses. I think a lot of what goes around comes around.
Absolutely. And Krysteana, thank you for coming. Krysteana is the editor-in-chief, and you've had to deal with a number of issues. Tell us about your three national awards. I mean, this is pretty impressive. We won first place in the design component of the Apple Awards from the Maine for the National Media Convention.
That is three more awards than I ever won.
Or me, and anything. Tell us a little bit about how you got our magazine to be of nationally recognized.
Sure. When we were in New York City, we ended up winning three awards. One was in first place best print ad. Another one was first place best design for advertisement. And then we won third place for best newspaper for 5,000 to 10,000 students. Mm-hmm. This was out of 120 colleges.
We're trying to get you into a higher category, but right now we're still between 8
and
10.
Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of the reasons that we won these awards was because of our format change. We went from a tabloid, which is your average newspaper, up to a flat tab, which is sort of magazine-esque style. It has a photo on the cover.
I really like the upgrade a lot.
Thank you.
Really, it does it very, very impressive. interested. Very attractive to pick up and easy to pick up.
Yeah, and that was the idea going in with it, to get people to look at it, because with the changing world of journalism and particularly on campus, we want students to be more attracted to a print piece rather than, you know, online at this point. So.
Well, and I've read your articles and your editorials personally. Very thoughtful, balanced, really kind of above where you should be at your young age.
You
know, you just have a maturity about you. Tell us what your goals are. Do you want to be similar to Neil? Would you like to write for the New York Times at some point?
I would love to write for the New York Times. That's always kind of been something I dreamed of as a child. A lot of my goals, as I continue to grow, because I am a senior, I would like to do some traveling. I'd like to go to grad school, a little bit of education, but kind of stay in the journalism field as I go. Freelancing is something I've always liked doing. I've done some internships locally and worked at other papers, so I hope to project out in that way.
Can I ask you both too, you're great and gifted writers. I mean, do you do stuff when you're not writing critiques of television shows, Neil and Krysteana? Do you write in journals? Do you write poetry? Are there other parts? I mean, is that your form? Is it your passion beyond just your sort of your journalism? Or do you go home and say, I never want to write anything but a tweet at this point?
I do a little storytelling in New York now and again. There's a storytelling thing called The Moth that people have probably heard about, where I've won some moth nights, I'm pleased to say. And so I do that kind of thing.
Those are fascinating, by the way. I mean, I'm either laughing or crying. I mean, it's just amazing how people who are not necessarily professional stand-up storytellers can come and say, this happened in my life, and you go, oh my God, it's really wonderful.
And it's a really excellent writing exercise to learn how to structure there's 5-minute time limit at the Moth, and to learn how to structure your story to fit that time frame, you really have to think it through. If you go to one of these open Moth storytelling things, you'll see a lot of people who didn't rehearse, they didn't think it through, and the punchline of their story comes in the first minute, and then there's four more minutes of story after that. So whether you're a...
Like the speeches of the USM president.
Exactly.
It needs some help.
Probably a lot like that.
We're going to come back to Neil and Jerry Seinfeld. We're going to come back to that story in just a minute. Krysteana, how about you? Do you do anything that other than write in the journal, in the magazine?
Yeah, so I like writing in a journal. I like to write little things that I think of throughout the day, because I find that story ideas kind of come and go like sporadically as I'm going about my day. So I write that down. I first initially got interested in writing via poetry. It was in a evening class when I went to Thornton Academy.
You can
Academy.
Share with any of that with us someday?
I have a lot of them. They just kind of sit in a binder. But my favorite kind of stories to tell are people's stories. I think that a lot of interesting social issues in the world today can be told from the perspective of the people that are actually experiencing them. And other than that, I like writing op-eds. I like the personal opinion pieces because I think it's important to take them from a perspective where you can stand a middle ground, really look at the issue in a way that's, a mindset in which is appropriate. Like, I'm not leaning any particular way. I try and look at it from an intellectual perspective. Mm. So that's kind of writing.
And I see that. It's very powerful.
Thank you.
Neil, tell us, Jerry Seinfeld, 2 million Twitter followers, and you have 1,000 Twitter followers, and yet you took him on.
I have 3,000 now.
Thanks to Jerry Seinfeld.
Six or seven years ago, I wrote a piece in the Times that was sort of poking fun at the overuse of the phrase "really" in television shows that I was seeing. It was turning up in comedies. It was turning up in dramas. Really, and I sort of criticized the writing, the use of that phrase as sort of a crutch by a writer. It prevents them from having to write an actual scene of dialogue where people are arguing with each other. You just have this one word dismissive moment. So I wrote that article. It was kind of tongue in cheek. And Jerry Seinfeld writes a letter to the editor about this article. His letter to the editor was also tongue in cheek because, of course, Jerry Seinfeld that's where that phrase came from, is off of Seinfeld. And it was a humorous little exchange, but it got blown up as Times Critic takes on Jerry Seinfeld, or Jerry Seinfeld takes on Times Critic. But it was kind of funny to watch that. But it was also great for my story because it was probably the most read story I've ever written at the Times, because once Jerry Seinfeld wrote a letter about it and then tweeted it, that got me to 2 million right. Twitter followers that I did not have.
Well, in your honor, we're gonna ban the word "really" in any administrative discussions here at all.
So that's
thank you. And so, Krysteana, as you think about kind of where you want to be, and we think about some of the stuff around TV critics, particular angle on journalism. I mean, it's obviously a passion for you around arts and performances and those kind of things. Is it something that you would do similar to that, or are you interested in international affairs, or interested in? You kind of talked about the telling the story.
Yeah. In terms of what I'm interested in for reporting?
Yeah.
I really like I had said, social issues. I'm really interested in the criminal system. Mm-hmm. It was very interesting when that report came out from the Muskie School where they talked about the juvenile records under 18 not being secured. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to go into those kind of topics and talk to the people, gather statistics at the same time. Investigative reporting is what I really like doing. Yeah. It's not something you can do all the time. It's kind of currently like one big project I'm working on, but definitely social issues.
Yeah, huge amount of investment in investigative journalism,
but
powerful. Tell us, Neil, what shows are you allowed to do this? Shows you might recommend that we watch. You had mentioned one to me earlier that I will pass on to my wife.
I have unusual tastes, everyone should know, and I also don't watch people assume I see every television show because I'm a TV critic. There are, in fact, 4 TV critics at the New York Times, so every time a show gets assigned to one of the other ones, all I can say is, thank God, that's a show I don't have to watch, because there are so many TV shows. But that said, I like a show called American Crime, which is now in its third season. I love a show called Bates Motel, which is about to have its finale. Yeah. I like some of the weird comedies, animated comedies on Adult Swim that no one else at the Times was ever going to write about because they're too out there. I like Robot Chicken. I like Super Mansion. And if you don't know what those shows are,
that may be a good sign.
Don't even try watching them because they're too outrageous. You can't handle it. I like a broad range of stuff, and I also like documentaries. I review a lot of documentaries because nobody else wants to review them.
I love documentaries. Give us one or two you really like.
HBO had a interesting Syria documentary a couple of weeks ago that I wrote about that was interestingly timed, if nothing else. There's a documentary last year that was just a fabulous piece of work that nobody saw. It was called, something like Miriam and Donna or something like that. It was a documentary about a mother and daughter. Daughter was intellectually disabled. Mm. Mother was in her 90s, still caring for this woman who was now in her 60s. And it was all about them reaching the point where the mother was no longer able to care for this child. It's just an absolutely wrenching piece of filmmaking.
Yeah.
So those kind of documentaries, they talk about the golden age of television, and they're usually talking about dramas, but there's a golden age of documentaries going on as well as viewers of PBS or HBO or a couple of the other outlets that air these shows know very well. There's a lot of good docs out there.
Mm, good. Yeah, thank you for that. Those are great tips. Krysteana, in a similar vein, tell us maybe what you have, as being a journalist, what you've learned about the university, what you kind of see as our next big challenges going forward. As you've kind of had to be one of a student of the university itself in many ways, what would you recommend that we keep our eye on as we go forward the next few years?
I think it's really important. The political atmosphere right now is very tense, especially on university campuses. There's this huge issue with the political spectrum. There's extreme liberalism, the conservatism, and it kind of has been very, very tense. I think as the years continue on. I think it's important that USM continues its transparency, especially the administration. I think it's important that, and on a personal level, I've mentioned it prior, but communication is key. I think that that's something that all freshmen should be sort of learning when they come in, that because it's one of those things that we kind of take for granted. It's not necessarily taught as a skill growing up. So just learning more communication skills, trying to understand these differences, and kind of moving forward in that way.
Yeah, I agree. Thank you. And you've expressed that a couple of times. So I want to thank you both. This is very wonderful for us to have, you know, kind of a gifted young writer who's been a tremendous editor-in-chief for us, being able to look at you and your career and say, you know, there's a place for me out there in that field that I love. And that's a wonderful thing in its own right. We're also honored to have you as an alumni. So thank you, Neil, for being with us and spending some time with us. I know we're bugging you to do a couple other events with us today, and we're just really grateful. So thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Appreciate it. And Krysteana, thank you again for your leadership at the university.